Of course, I am going to talk on hysteroscopy in the elderly, means if somebody who's had menopause for a minimum period of 10 years. So generally, chronologically, it is 60 and above. So very elderly, beyond 70 and 80 also, there are some technical issues involved in hysteroscopy, and my talk is going to be restricted on that. Today, we know that life expectancy is increasing. So on the same ground, characteristic clinical conditions specific to the elderly because of the changes in the genital tract causes specific problem, increasing the scope to scope the uterus. And today, if you see the indications for hysteroscopy in very elderly, basically first and foremost is of course the postmenopausal bleeding, but incidental finding of a thick endometrium or fluid inside the uterine cavity for a sonography done for some other reason. Pyometra, which is seen in almost 13 to 15% of elderly of age group, and the median age of pyometra is supposed to be 65 years, and occasionally a forgotten foreign device. Most of the time it is an intrauterine device placed during a reproductive age group. But any surgery comes with specific challenges. And in the elderly, apart from the anesthesia related problems which are due to the comorbidities, which will be very common at the age of 70 and 80, most of them have COPD, reduced ventricular ejection fraction, but difficulty in positioning, which is so important on hysteroscopy. Most of them have skeletomuscular disorders, have undergone knee, hip replacement surgeries, and many a time my OT boys have to just hold the leg, and this is the maximum stretch which I can have, and never have it, can put it on the lithotomy rod. But specific to us, the genital tract atrophy causes the cicatrization of the external, the cervical canal, and the internal loss. The cervical lip in most of the case may be either absent or very short, absolutely not possible to hold the cervix. More than that, there is muscular thinning of the myometrium, which in some cases may reduce to almost 50% of the women in the reproductive age group, and chances of perforation is very high. So in a case of malignancy, if you perforate, whether are we upstaging the disease, and fluid dynamics, which is so important in hysteroscopy, becomes more so in the patient who have had reduced ventricular ejection fraction. So you have to keep a real monitoring on the fluid overload and the electrolyte balance. And the venous sinuses in the myometrium in a normal reproductive age group, which is supposed to be up to 15 millimeter, in a flaccid postmenopausal uterus, it is further less, causing increase in intravasation. And hypothermia, such a big problem in elderly, gets aggravated because of the fluid absorption further. So you have to keep all this, and further we have the limitation for taking out the biopsy. The thinner the endometrium, it's going to be thin because the tissue given to the histopathologist has to be sufficient for him or her to really study. And we also have to always keep an eye on the malignant spread, which is going to go through the ostia into the peritoneal cavity. Now, as far as the concern of dissemination and hysteroscopy, there are a lot of studies, and this study by Chen and Clark, where they studied the duration of hysteroscopy had no effect on the amount of cells which is present in the peritoneal cavity. Liquid media definitely had more cells than gaseous media or CO2 if we use, but the presence of peritoneal fluid containing malignant cells percentage was about 12 to 13% in patients who had undergone hysteroscopy, whereas those who underwent DNC only had about 1.6%. And this video, you can see by vision itself that this is a classical case of adenocarcinoma. Even before the biopsy or hysteroscopy can tell that this is purely adenocarcinoma. Of course, a final tissue diagnosis is definitely needed, but hysteroscopy gives you that great advantage of diagnosing by the tissue quality itself. Now, as far as the other concern is, none of them have shown any worsening of the prognosis, even if cells were found. Possibly, the free floating tumor cells in the peritoneal cavity lack the microenvironment and nutrition needed for the tumor growth, resulting in the loss of tumor activity. But hysteroscopy helps you to, you know, locate the site. All cases, the adenocarcinoma may not be global. It may be focal, as you see in this case. So you need to localize it, get a targeted biopsy, and that's where the role of hysteroscopy is undoubtedly take the golden rule. Definitely, one has to overcome the challenges before we embark upon surgery in such 70 and 80 year old women. A proper preoperative diagnosis with excellent imaging, a good workup, which may include in many, most of the cases, a 2D echo at that age. That's where the role of hysteroscopy is. Proper counseling and a well-equipped anesthesia setup is required with a good surgical or SICU backup. In patients who are unfit, one may opt for ambulatory, or this regional anesthesia or spinal is definitely a level B evidence that it is preferable over general anesthesia when GA is contraindicated. Now, apart from the newer instrumentation like 4mm operative sheath and a 2mm telescope, I would prefer the miniature resectoscope in the elderly because dilatation is such a difficult problem, and a 5mm or a 6mm resectoscope has to be on my operating table whenever I'm dealing with a woman at the age of 70 or 80. Now, how to overcome the challenges which we face? First and foremost, we do today hysteroscopy definitely by not putting any speculum, even in reproductive age group, don't dilate, but more becomes pertinent because holding the cervix in a postmenopausal 70-year-old lady is almost impossible. So no need to panic. Your 2mm grasper goes through the operative sheath and helps you just dilate under vision, make it to 4mm. Occasionally you might have to nick in, and this you can see the atrophic cervical canal with a polyp and the internal os is further fibrous because she's been menopausal for almost 15 years. And no need, again here, the same grasper or the seizure under visual dilatation is all that is required under if you do a blind dilatation, 100% perforation is a possibility in these cases, but follow the anatomy of the cervical mucosal fold and enter into the cavity. You can see that the internal os has started appearing. You can push that 4mm sheath and you can see such multiple polyps. And luckily for the patient and for the gynecologist, this all look benign in spite of 15 or 20 polyps inside the cavity. You can just pluck it out and remove one by one and send it for biopsy. Specific pathology seen in the elderly. Endometrial polyp, as I already said, it is a very common condition, but you need to know the size preoperatively. You wouldn't want to waste your time by putting a diagnostic sheet, then an operative sheet, because the fluid overload has to be always taken care. You can see on the right video, even that small resectoscope goes in or walks in without dilatation. Giving a virgin view, no need of dilatation, that small 5mm, 5.5 mm resectoscope has been selected because this polyp was diagnosed to be almost 3 cm, and it is going to be difficult to cut it with scissors unless you started incising with a bipolar needle, whereas this resectoscope will help you to use energy and do a faster resectoscope and finish the surgery faster before the fluid overload goes above the specified limit. On the other side, left side, you can see the atrophic endometrium. The pedicle is very long, very short, but the endometrial polyp is almost 4 cm, but the diameter by sonography was just about 1 cm. So we decide to go in with the scissors only through the small 4mm operative sheath. And all you need to do is just nip at the base where it is attached to the fundus, whereas resectoscope for a large polyp is required for resection. And once you have resected it, once you have cut it, all you need is just a grasper, because this polyp will automatically very easily come. You need to have just a proper angling of the scope and you can pull the polyp with your grasper totally out and send it for biopsy as seen here. So it becomes very simple in such smaller polyp diameter. Well, you may not be lucky all the time. This 74-year-old lady diagnosed her a large 5-centimeter polyp because of her presenting as postmenopausal bleeding. I had never seen such a big polyp, even in reproductive age group. Here we could walk in with the resectoscope of 9mm, because larger the polyp, I would prefer a larger resectoscope. And most of you will agree, whenever you have such a large lesion occupying the full of the uterine cavity, the internal os is usually dilated. So in this lady, we could walk in even with a 9mm resectoscope without any dilatation. And then the job becomes simple. Just because of the larger diameter of the loop, you can cut larger chunks and complete the surgery in quick time. You get to hardly 10 minutes or 15 minutes in this age group, and you can just resect it fast. Of course, I use
preoperatively. You wouldn't want to waste.
This is the tissue which we did get, but in a patient suspected to have carcinoma, Well, whenever you have carcinoma, you can, if the polyp is big, you can take out the biopsy very easily because of the size of the polyp itself, and many times appearance itself tells you, but it may not be the case where, as I showed you, that if the it's a small focal area, you need to take a perfectly targeted biopsy from the perfect site. So you need to have the grasper or the scissor dig it into the endometrium or the lesion where it is there, lift the whole thing to get a big chunk. Whereas this on the right side, you can appreciate that this is purely definitely adenocarcinoma. Whereas here on the left side, we need to localize it. You can see how it is lifted up to have a bigger chunk, because you need to submit a bigger chunk to the pathologist for a proper diagnosis. Occasionally, I use the scissors to cut the tissue rather than just pull it with the grasper, because then you get it a very small piece and then pull out the whole tissue under vision, and you get such a big chunk, and the pathologist is definitely happy to, you know, give you the perfect diagnosis. Pyometra, such a common problem in women beyond 70. This lady, who was almost 83 or 84, had undergone twice dilatation for that irritating problem. She was absolutely fit and a nice Sindhi lady. She walked to my consulting and said, "Beta, mujhe isse nikal dur kar do meri problem." And one has to be very gentle when you're putting hysteroscope in an inflamed uterus, because not only the muscle is thinner, they are also very softer because of the inflammation. So take your own time. You can see the purulent discharge coming out of the internal os, but your patients will tell you that you should wait rather than take out the hysteroscope multiple times, because the chances of perforation will increase. So just wait, let the fluid go in, wash it out, and open the suction occasionally. You can see so much of purulent material inside the uterine cavity here, just standing at the internal os. One can judge the amount of fluid which is there, the pus which is there, going in slowly, letting the fluid wash out all the purulent discharge. You can see totally the cavity is obscured by the presence, but time will give you a perfect view of the whole cavity, because you need to rule out malignancy. Almost one third of patients with pyometra can have malignancy underlying, so you need to take a biopsy if required, or even if not, I would suggest that biopsy should be taken in every patient of pyometra. So in this patient, after waiting, you can see that the pus is still coming, but you have to drain it out completely and send it for culture. And we did take a biopsy from all the four corners of the uterine cavity, but no area there was any focal area of inflammation or suspicion of malignancy. It was a generalized congestion which is there. And just finally, the biopsy came normal. We did keep a catheter inside the uterine cavity for 48 hours, and the good antibiotic coverage. The patient was followed for further 1 year, and she is completely relieved of her pyometra and the chronic irritating discharge which was there. And she really helped her by the hysteroscopic procedure, even at that age of 84. You can see the flakes of, you know, pus still present, and you have to just spend time in washing it up totally thoroughly. You can see focal area of, you know, redness. We did take biopsy from these sites. It's mandatory, and sending it for biopsy apart from the culture, which also came normal. Now, this was a very This was a very peculiar case of a 66-year-old where the cervix was not visible from cerebellum. She had undergone two cesarean sections, and sonography was inconclusive. Even an MRI showed a 4.5 centimeter lesion in the posterior part of the cervix, or upper part of the vagina, but she was complaining of chronic leukorrhea. Nobody could see the cervix. Nobody could diagnose. No amount of vaginal tablets, you know, helped her. So this particular patient, when we went in with the hysteroscope, what we found was fantastic. The uterus was adherent because of the previous two sections. You can see two dimplings on the right side and the left side, which is so narrow. So we entered one cavity, which was absolutely normal. And what was seen was a pyometra in one horn of a bicornate uterus, which could not have been diagnosed and treated if this hysteroscope was not possible. You can see the other side of the ostia, others at the external os, which is there. You can just open it up and we enter the uterine cavity. You can see the similar case, like a lot of purulent discharge. So this was a very interesting case of pyometra of the uterus, of a bicornate uterus. Of course, this lady also did not have any signs of suggestion of malignancy, poor antibiotic care, and follow-up absolutely relieved her of her distressing condition. And this is just to highlight the importance of, you know, hysteroscopy in a pyometra patient. Now, occasional complications do occur. Here, in a case of menopausal uterus with a large polyp, we did the mistake of not lysing, cutting it before. We just cut at the base and tried to pull it out through the grasper, and you can see the polyp size. It was not coming out because of, there was no dilatation. And after two attempts, I did put in an ovum forceps to see whether I can just pull out it out, and but I could not get the polyp. And so what we decided was to put in the hysteroscope again, but there I realized that definitely I had perforated. But we need to put in a laparoscope because we needed that polyp for tissue diagnosis, because we needed something to prove that there is no malignancy. And that is the only reason we put in a laparoscope. Otherwise, in such perforation, you don't need to. Ultimately, we did find the polyp not inside the abdominal cavity, in the tub underneath the patient's table. So literature review, Betoki et al., who have had such a large series of hysteroscopy more in the office, they proved that in 98.5% of cases, even the severest of cervical stenosis could be tackled by technical maneuvers and miniaturized mechanical or bipolar needle or graspers, but maintain the strict fluid overload criteria. So in a very elderly age group, you have to limit the fluid in the case of glycine to 750 ml, and in case of saline, maximum is 1000 ml, though you may use furosemide, but keep the intrauterine pressure to almost just 40-45 by keeping the inflow pressure to less than 100. And this was the only literature where I found where they gave 25 microgram of vaginal estradiol for 14 days for cervical priming. And 12 hours before the hysteroscopy, they put in 1000 micrograms of vaginal misoprostol. But I have no personal experience of doing this. I have never found difficulty in the way I do. And to conclude, friends, there is definitely an increase in trend to scope the uterus in the elderly or very elderly beyond 70 and 80s, but a proper preoperative diagnosis, a good preoperative evaluation, understanding the challenges and limitation, and adhering to safety guideline will definitely make you overcome any difficulty you find and will make the life interesting, not only for you, but not for that poor elderly lady beyond 75 or 80. Thanks for a patient hearing.